A single database server can only store and process a limited amount of data. If you find a way to horizontally scale your database, you can potentially store unlimited amount of data. So database sharding is simply splitting a large database into smaller pieces, which we call shards. If you get lucky and attract more and more customers, the amount of data also increases over the time. Now, the database becomes a bottleneck if too many users attempt to use the application to read or save data simultaneously. The application slows down, negatively affecting the user experience. So, sharding not only allows you to store more data, but also improves performance by reducing latency for each query. This is because you can now push down the query to each individual shard, which has a smaller dataset. There are three main reasons why you should be using sharding. First of all, response time. By splitting a database into smaller datasets, it improves query performance, as it needs to search through fewer rows compared to a monolithic database. Second, it can help to avoid total service outage. Most of the time, we're not only splitting data across different database servers, but we also configure replication. So if one shard becomes unavailable, the data can be accessed and restored from another shard. Finally, a growing database consumes more computing resources and eventually reaches storage capacity. There are only so many disks you can attach to a single server. Therefore, sharding can solve this problem by scaling the database horizontally instead of vertically. Also, you can add shards at a runtime without shutting down application for maintenance. Now, let's see how sharding works. A typical unsharded database stores data in multiple columns and rows. So, database sharding splits a single dataset into partitions or shards. Each shard contains unique rows of data, which are stored separately across multiple computers called nodes. All the shards run on separate nodes but share the same schema or design. The partitioned data chunks are called logical shards. The machine that stores the logical shard is called a physical shard or database node. Keep in mind that a physical shard can contain multiple logical shards that belong to the same table. Now, software developers would use a shard key to decide how to partition a dataset. A column in a dataset, such as customer name, determines which rows of data group together to form a shard. Developers can choose a shard key from existing column or create a new one. Database sharding operates on shared nothing architecture. Each physical shard operates independently and is unaware of other shards. Only the physical shards containing the data you request will process the data in parallel. Above the shard, we have another abstraction software layer that coordinates data storage and access across these multiple shards. For instance, some databases have automatic sharding features built in. In others, you, as a software developer, need to write sharding code to store or retrieve data from the correct shard. Now, let's discuss different approaches you can take to shard your database. One of the simplest methods might be to use range-based sharding, also known as dynamic sharding. This approach splits database rows based on the range of values. For example, suppose you decide to use customer's name as a sharding key. Now, let's say you want to create three shards. In the first shard, you would place all customer records if the customer's name starts with a letter between A and I. For the second shard, you would use letters J through S. And for the third one, you would use T through Z. Every time you write or retrieve data from the database, your application or database checks the first letter of the customer's name and places that record in the corresponding shard. Depending on the data values, range-based sharding can result in overloading of data on a single physical node. In our example, the first range from A to I might contain significantly more customer names than, for instance, the third shard, where names start with T to Z. However, this method is easier to implement. The next method is hashed sharding. In this case, we use mathematical formula and apply it to each row in the database. For example, in this case, we can have two shards. So if the hash function takes all the customer record values and produces one, we will store it in shard number one. And if the hash function returns two, we will store it in the shard two. In the real world, these shards, of course, operate on a range of hash values that the function can return. The benefit of this approach is that it can produce even data distribution among physical shards. But on the other hand, since these hash values do not represent any business meaning, it may become challenging in the long run to reassign the hash values when adding more physical shards. Another way you can use is directory sharding. This approach uses a lookup table to decide where to store the record. For example, let's consider that you may store some items in the database and you can have item color lookup table. Each color would have its own shard. For instance, blue items will be stored in shard A, red items will be stored in shard B, etc. This approach is very flexible. Each shard is a meaningful representation of the database and is not limited by ranges. The only problem you may face is if something happens to your lookup table and if the table contains incorrect information about shard distribution. The last type that we're going to discuss is geo-sharding. This type of sharding is based on the physical geolocation associated with the record. For example, a dating site can store users in different shards based on their locations. You can use the city as a sharding key to decide where to place the record. The biggest advantage of this approach is that you can now serve relevant data from the database in the same region. Therefore, since the distance between the end user and the data location is shorter, the response time will be also improved. If the data access patterns are mostly based on geolocation, this approach works great. However, geosharding can also result in uneven data distribution. Now let's talk about how to properly select a sharding key. When a data overload happens on the specific physical shards and others remain underloaded, it results in database hotspots. Hotspots slow down the retrieval process on the database and defeating the purpose of data sharding. Good shard key selection can evenly distribute data across multiple shards. First of all, you need to think about all possible values for the shard key, also known as cardinality. For instance, if you choose yes or no data field as a shard key, the number of shards is restricted to only two. Next is the frequency, which is the probability of storing specific data in a particular shard. For example, if you choose age as a shard key for a fitness website, most of the records might go into nodes for subscribers aged 30 to 45, resulting in database hotspots. Finally, you need to consider monotonic change. This is the rate of change of the shard key. For example, a feedback database can be split into three different physical shards. The first shard is for customers who have made 0 to 10 purchases. The second shard is for those with 11 to 20 purchases. And the third one is for customers with 21 or more purchases. As the business grows, customers will make more than 21 purchases, which will result in data hotspot in the third shard. That's the basics of the database sharding. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.